when I was a student, you know, when Pablo came, my colleague, into the cafeteria and told me they demonstrated quantum teleportation in the lab. That was in Vienna. That was Anton Seilinger. It was in a tabletop experiment. So you have like a table that could fit in this room, let's say, with mirrors and lasers and so on. And that's how experiments look like in those times. Then Anton, some years later, wanted to see how big can the distances, can the experiment grow such that you still have entanglement. So this is entanglement between photons. Okay. And he was able to demonstrate entanglement across two different buildings in Vienna. So, well, that was very promising. So he said, well, let's keep going. And then in 2011, he was already doing the experiment across 144 kilometers in the Canary Islands.
Oh, so they're not physically connected tubes that connected the two buildings, nor in this 1,000 kilometer case.
Well, there are many experiments that are connected by a waveguide. People do experiments like that, but no, these are like free space experiments.
Interesting.
Yeah, they're beautiful. They're very, very interesting. So Anton had a student from China who then moved back to China. And then, you know, he's made a lot of progress there. And together they launched a satellite, which is called Micus, which is completely purposed to study quantum entanglement and teleportation and cryptography and so on. So this was, they launched it in 2016. And then they've demonstrated entanglement across thousands of kilometers.
Right.
So that's very interesting. No, because this whole notion of quantum mechanics applies to very small scales. Now we see that that's not the case. Well, of course, photons are, you know, they're not massive systems or anything like that. But already, I think this starts showing that this division of what are the scales where quantum applies and where it's a different, maybe in some senses, as we first thought it would be, no? But well, I mean, what's very interesting is, like, as I mentioned before, at the scales where satellites operate, relativity kicks in. No, again, the proper time of clocks measured on Earth is different to the clocks that you said that are in a satellite. So you have to take into account at least a gravitational redshift. So this is like special relativistic effect, but more than that. So that is something that I've been very interested in. I have a whole series of papers that use quantum field theory in curved space-time to describe the space-time of the Earth using, for example, the Schwarzschild metric, which can be applied to this case. And then you describe the photons and the quantum states that travel from Earth to a satellite or between links and between different satellites as using quantum field theory in curved space-time. You can solve the equations and then construct wave packets and study how the, let's say if you send a wave packet from Earth to a satellite, how would this be modified due to the curvature of the space-time under light? So this is no longer just special relativity using gravitational redshift. That was what people were using. We showed that if you use quantum field theory in curved space-time, you could actually go beyond that and really see how the curvature of space-time affects the, for example, we wrote some of these papers and we said, this is what the curvature, how would it affect, for example, quantum teleportation or quantum cryptography? And then you could turn things around and use the fact that these states are modified to actually estimate the space-time parameters of the Earth using quantum metrology.
Okay,
so that's
cool.
That's area of interest, and I've written a series of papers in that direction, more or less trying to answer this sort of questions. But you see, these are experiments that already are taking place. And actually, there was a group working in Germany that once the whole group came to visit mine because they had some results they were not understanding, and they using just the gravitational redshift, and they wanted to see if there was more to be understood from our work. So this is instance where you do see that some interplay between quantum states and the space-time of the Earth, the experiments reach those scales, but there's very little apart, you know, from our work. I don't see that there's many more things, or the experiments actually, they take into account the gravitational redshift, but they still have to test this sort of things. Now, quantum field theory in curved space-time has not been demonstrated in the experiment. Quantum field theory, yes, I mean, so many times, that's what CERN and Fermilab and all of these experiments are about. But when you have gravity included, it still needs to be demonstrated. So some of these predictions that we make could start giving you some hints that quantum field theory in curved space-time, let's say it's a good theory for these scales. It would be very nice to check that.
So for the audience member who's thinking, how does this work logistically? Do you have to petition for time from this satellite, or do you have to ask the people who are in charge of the satellite to perform an experiment? Like, how does it work?
Well, I actually belong to a group that was some sort of a consortium in which they work together with the theoreticians, with the experimentalists, and the group sort of discussed about which would be things that would be interesting to study. So the theoreticians would say, well, we would like to test this theory. Let's say I had a colleague, Tim Ralph, who came up with a new theory that used quantum field theory in curved space-time, but went beyond that and take into account closed time-like curves.
Right.
And then he proposed an experiment. And then the group found this interesting from a theoretical point of view. But the important thing there was that the experimentalist found it feasible to do the experiment. And the experiment was done. And the experiment didn't find evidence of this sort of new theory. But you see, that is the sort of thing, it's great. That's the sort of thing you want to be doing, that people are creative, come up with new ideas. Again, the circle, cast it in language first, then in the language of theoretical physics, which is mathematics, make predictions. The experimentalists go test and they say, well, yes or no, and then you go on. So I think that there are groups like that, and usually also what we do is that we get together theoreticians with experimentalists and make a proposal that might or not get funded. Of course, with space-based experiments is more complicated. I have actually been approached by NASA a few times, and they asked me, do you have an experiment that you think we could do? But the things I've been working on lately are more things that you could also test on Earth. And then you need to justify the expense.
Uh-huh.
But, well, these, I did point out to these papers, and I said, well, I think it would be great if you could test some of these. But I haven't heard, like, oh, yes, we're doing it or anything like that yet.
If you enjoyed this TOE clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for TOE Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core TOE community. You'll also receive my top 10 TOEs. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.